So everyone has a unique way of speaking. For example, the way I'm speaking now, it's influenced by my gender, my age, where I'm from, the audience I'm talking to, the goal I have in mind, etc., etc. So the way language relates to society is something that has been studied for a very long time within linguistics, but more recently also gained a lot of attention in computational linguistics. And I think a lot of this interest is driven by data. So traditionally, a lot of social linguists, they collect data, for example, using surveys, using observations, and using interviews. And while this gives you a lot of detailed information, for example, about the participants, about the background, it's also very time-consuming. It could take years to collect the data, and a lot of times the samples that you get are also pretty limited. Another problem is the observer's paradox. So a lot of times you're interested when people are talking in an informal way, for example, with family or friends. But if you are asking people through surveys or in interviews, you have the risk that they adapt their answer to what they think the researcher likes to see. So that's also a big problem with these kind of research methods. And I think social media is a really interesting source to complement these existing data collection methods, because social media has a lot of informal language, a lot of contextual information, and a lot of people, they talk in an informal way. They don't really know that they're being observed. So social media is a really interesting source to study language and social behavior. However, if you try to analyze a model language in social media, you also encounter a lot of challenges. A lot of the natural language processing tools have been developed based on large corpora, and a lot of these corpora are based on newswire text. So for example, this is a fragment from the Washington Post last year about Leonardo DiCaprio finally winning his Oscar. But if you look at the same day, same event, but then if you look at messages, for example, on Twitter, you see that the language that you see on Twitter is very different than the language that you see in newspapers. For example, Oprah Winfrey, she says it happened. She's lengthening the happened, so she's repeating the P. And then she says, bravo, Leo, standing O in my PJs. And it's not that Oprah doesn't know how to write happened, right? She's doing this on purpose. She's doing this to emphasize maybe that finally Leo got his Oscar, to connect with the audience, to represent herself in a certain way. And so, well, a lot of people, they tend to say that language and social media are sloppy, it's noisy. Actually, a lot of the variation that we see in language carries social meaning. So by analyzing language, we can actually learn a lot about social dynamics and about people's backgrounds. So that's kind of my main research area. How can we use large-scale analyses of text? And I'm a lot very interested in social media text to study social phenomena. And I'm doing this mostly from the viewpoint of social linguistics. So social linguistics is an area within linguistics that studies the relation between language and society. But my background is computer science, so I'm mostly interested in data and in the methods. And then I collaborate with social linguists or social scientists to identify interesting research questions. And so together with a couple of co-authors, we recently wrote a survey article on this emerging area, which we call computational social linguistics. So if you're interested, I suggest taking a look at this article. So why is this research interesting? I think there are a lot of reasons why it's important to do this research. So first of all, it could help improve the natural language processing tools that we have. For example, if you're analyzing language in social media, you would want to analyze all messages that are relevant and not exclude certain messages from, for example, certain social groups, from younger people, older people, or people writing a dialect, for example. And so you want your tools to be robust against language variation. It's also an opportunity to test and refine theories, for example, proposed in social linguistics or the social scientists, using these large-scale naturalistic text data. It's also an opportunity to develop new analysis tools that social linguists and social scientists could use. And it also has a lot of practical applications, for example, supporting user profiling or doing more fine-grained analyses of online behavior. So today I'm going to give you a high-level overview of some of the research and also illustrate how they were motivated. So the first study that I will discuss is about outer age prediction. And I think this was mostly motivated by building tools that could help analyze online behavior and, for example, support user profiling applications. So as I've discussed, language can reveal a lot about people's backgrounds, for example, about their age or their gender. So these are all tweets from the same Twitter user. And this Twitter user was a Dutch Twitter user, but I put an English translation below. And I'd like you to read these tweets and give me a very quick guess whether you think this is written by a female or male, and also how old this person is.
Female 24.
Female 24. Anyone else?
Female
16. Okay, so this was a female 15. We asked this to 220 people. 96% of them guessed female. And on average, they guessed 16.7 years. So this is an example that with just a few tweets, you can already get a pretty good estimate of the background of this person. So of course, this is a really maybe easy example, but this is just to illustrate the task. So the question is, can we do this automatically? And we also looked at gender, but due to time constraints, I only discuss age. And so this is a very high-level overview of what we found. So we did experiments using data from Dutch Twitter users. We hired annotators who manually looked at the profiles, at the pictures, at the names, at the tweets to collect ground truth. And then we just trained a supervised machine learning model to predict the age. And we framed it as a regression problem. So we tried to predict the age in the number of years. And on average, we were less than 4 years off. So in general, a simple model, just based on words, already performed pretty well. But we did see that the model didn't work very well for all the Twitter users. And actually, if you look at the data, I think the data explains why. For example, the plot on the left shows you the relative frequency of words like I, me, my, etc. And so you see that young people talk more about themselves. So the red line are the females and the blue line are the males. We also see the females tend to talk a little more about themselves. But we see that the trend kind of flattens after around 30 years. And we also see that in other graphs. For example, word length increases by age, but also kind of flattens around after 30 years. Tweet length, number of links, and number of hashtags. So for an automatic model, just based on language, it's very hard to distinguish, for example, between a 40 and a 50-year-old person, just based on language. And we actually also asked people, so we developed an online game where we asked people to do the same task. And then we see something very similar. So the red graph shows you kind of the perfect line when the actual age would match the predicted age. And the black line is what we would get based on these human predictions. And so this is based on almost 42,000 guesses. And again, we see that humans tend to over-predict the ages of younger Twitter users, but really under-predict the ages of older Twitter users. And actually, if you go back to social linguistics, there are studies that suggest that between 30 and 55 years, people tend to talk in a more standardized way because they're concerned about making a career. They want to be taken seriously. And so it's in these age ranges that people tend to use standardized language, and then it's hard to make more fine-grained estimates based on their age, at least on Twitter. So the next thing that I'd like to discuss is an example of how research in this area could help improve processing informal language. So this was the first motivation. So within natural language processing, a lot of the tools have the assumption that the texts are written in a single language. However, a lot of people are actually multilingual, and they might switch between languages in face-to-face conversations, but also online. For example, this is a tweet by Dawson Kroes. She's a Dutch supermodel. And this is an example tweet where she's actually using three different languages in one message. So she uses English. She also uses Frisian, which is a Dutch minority language, Heitedij. And she's using Dutch, Vaderdag. So you can imagine messages like this are very difficult to process using standard natural language processing tools because there are multiple languages present in a single message. And so we looked at automatic language identification to help process these texts, because if you know the language of certain segments, then you can apply, for example, the right processing tools. And well, there's been a lot of research in automatic language identification. So far, the research really focused on identification at the document level or at the paragraph level. And so we looked at identification at the word level. And we used simple models like dictionary models, language models. But then we showed that using context, framing it as a sequence tagging task actually helped to improve the performance. And there have recently been several shared tasks on this topic, and people have come up with much more advanced models recently. And so we also looked at this task and pushed it a little bit further, because in the data, we sometimes even see people switching between languages within a single word. For example, Utverkort is, so Ut is associated with Limburgish, which is a Dutch minority language, and then Verkort is associated with Dutch. So two different languages are used to make this, to compose a single word. And we automatically segmented these words using Morfessor. So this is a tool to unsupervised segmentation. And then we identified the languages, and then we identified words that were composed of segments associated with different languages. And while this was promising, it highlighted some very interesting cases of switching between words. We also found that it identified a lot of named entities, for example. So a lot more pre-processing might be useful in this task. Okay. So the next study that I'd like to highlight is a study where we try to develop new analysis tools for social linguists and social scientists. And this was a study where we looked at dialects. So within linguistics and social linguistics, people have looked at regional variation. So for example, this is a plot based on Dutch Twitter data. And in Dutch, there are two different ways of referring to French fries, friet and patat. And so the color in each area indicates the relative frequency of a certain word. And if you look at this map, you see that people in the south of the Netherlands tend to use a different word than people in the north of the Netherlands, right? But however, so linguists, they traditionally manually select words that they want to look at, or they manually look at these maps and then decide on their own, for example, based on intuition or related work, whether it's interesting. But nowadays, for example, with Twitter, we can potentially generate thousands and thousands of these maps. So we need a statistical method that can measure whether the variation that we're seeing, whether the pattern that we're seeing, if it's truly significant, or if it's just because of random noise. Right, so more formally, is there a dependence between, on the one hand, the feature values? So this could be the relative frequency of a certain word, or a binary variable indicating the presence of a certain word, and why the locations? So this could be GPS coordinates. And so the null hypothesis would be that there's no spatial dependence. And what we'd like is to have a method that can really exploit fine-grained information. So if you have GPS coordinates, we want to be able to use the GPS coordinates directly. It should also be applicable to all types of data, binary data, categorical data, frequency data. And it should also be able to detect nonlinear dependence, because a lot of research has shown that variation in language is often not linear. And so while there already exist methods to do this, they have some limitations. So I won't discuss them because of time constraints, but we did compare against several methods that were proposed in literature. So that the method that we were looking at is based on a method that has been developed in the machine learning community, which is the Hilbert-Smith independence criterion. And so when we have x and y, and if they're independent, then the covariance is zero. However, it doesn't have to hold in the opposite direction. So if the covariance is zero, then there could still be dependence between x and y, because covariance is a linear measure. So if you look at the graph on the left, there's a very strong dependence between x and y, and so the Pearson correlation, which is a normalized version of the covariance, is very high. If you look at the figure on the right, there's also a very strong dependence between x and y, but then the Pearson correlation is close to zero, and that's because it's not a linear trend. But if you transform the data, so instead of looking at x and y, looking at x squared and y, you would get a very high correlation. So the idea is proposed by Gretten et al. Is to look at covariance in high dimensional space so that you can detect nonlinear dependence. And the nice thing of HSIG is that also suitable for all types of data as long as you can construct the right kernel. So this is a very high-level overview of the idea. So HSIG is based on kernel embeddings. So you map a probability distribution to a point in a high dimensional, potentially infinite dimensional space, and then you can compare these embeddings in the feature space. So if you'd like to know whether two samples are drawn from different distributions, you can look at the square distance between the bendings of x and y, for example. If you'd like to know if they're independent, then you can compare the joint distribution with the product of the marginals. And if because you're doing this in this space, you're able to detect nonlinear dependence. So the problem is if you just apply these methods on some empirical data set that we have, then it's really hard to compare against existing methods because we don't have ground truth. So that's why we first did some experiments with syntactic data. For example, this simulates variation from east to west. And here is a selection of the results. So H-SIG is the green line, and then we compared against three other methods. And the x-axis shows you the amount of data, and the y-axis is the power. So for each particular setting, we ran 100 to 120 experiments, and then we calculated how often the methods correctly rejected the hypothesis. Because it was syntactic data, we know that there's truly geographical variation going on. And we see that H-SIG performs pretty well, especially when we have lots of data. And also we see that when the variation is linear, so when the dependence is linear, it's much easier than when it's non-linear. We also applied H-SIG on Twitter data just as an exploratory tool. And if you just look at the top words ranked according to H-SIG, we actually get a lot of names to, for cities and names for regions. And while these words are not very interesting from a linguistic point of view, it does make sense, right? Because you expect that city names are highly dependent on the location. But so this is an example of how machine learning tools could be used to scale up or help process text to study social linguistic questions. So the final study that I'd like to discuss is one where we're looking at online health campaigns. And this is an example of how large scale text analysis can help to test existing theories in social sciences. So in this particular project, we collaborated with the Movember campaign. I think you might know the Movember campaign, yeah. So it's about men's health, and they focused a lot on cancer, but also more recently on mental health. And the campaign is probably most well known because it runs in November and they encourage men to grow a mustache, for which you can then donate money. So the question is, if you look at data in this campaign, we see that a lot of people sign up, but then some people waste thousands and thousands of dollars and some people waste no money at all. So the question is, why do people waste more money than other people? And if we understand this process, then maybe the campaign can be made more effective. And so within the social sciences, there's this model called the social identity model of collective action, which proposes different types of motivations. And the idea is that individual motivations to participate in the campaign can help explain why some people waste more money than other people. So the first motivation is the injustice motivation. And it's a shared emotion that includes both affective and cognitive perceptions of an unfair situation. So this could mean that the person had cancer themselves, or they know someone who had cancer. So you can think of phrases like, you know, my dad, or I had testicular cancer. The second motivation is the social identity motivation. It's a sense of belonging together that emerges out of common attributes, experiences, external labels. So for this particular motivation, the fun aspect of the campaign is very important, and also the social aspect. Because your friends are participating, that's why you are participating. And the last motivation is the collective efficacy motivation. And this is a shared belief that as a group, you can make a difference in this case. So the nice thing of the Movember campaign is that people who participate, they have an online profile. And in this online profile, they actually describe their motivation in free text. And so this is one of the top raisers of last year in the UK. He's a public figure. And he describes that his grandfather and his uncle, for example, had cancer. And so what we want to do is, could we automatically extract motivations of people, why they participate, and then test whether these motivations have an influence on how much money people waste. And so we're using this using text classification again, using a supervised machine learning system. So we manually annotated a subset of the data. We trained a logistic regression model. And then these are the results that we got. So for the injustice motivation, we obtained a pretty high F score. And for collective efficacy, it was a little bit lower. But for that particular category, we also observed that the annotate agreement was a little bit lower. And so note that these motivations are not mutually exclusive. So someone can have multiple motivations. And these are the top ranked features that we got. So for example, for the injustice motivation, you see words like cancer or friends, lost father, etc. For the social identity motivation, you have words like fun, team, mustache, etc. ranked high. So they do seem to match the intuition. And then we applied a classifier to all the Movember profiles that we had. So these were about 90,000 profiles. We looked at the US and the UK. And then we do see that, for example, people with an injustice motivation raise significantly more money than people with other types of motivation. We also see that participants with a social identity motivation are more often part of a team, and that people who are part of a team raise significantly more money. So this is an example where we can take a model from social sciences and apply it to large-scale amount of text using machine learning. Yeah. So I've given you some examples on a very high level of how text can be used to analyze social cultural phenomena. I think it's a really exciting time to work on this. I'm also pretty excited about increasing interaction between, for example, computer scientists and social scientists. But also, there are still a lot of open challenges that need to be addressed. For example, making machine learning models more interpretable, especially when you're collaborating with social scientists, for example, it's important that they understand what the model has learned, why a certain prediction has been made. Also, in my own research, I focused a lot on language in a certain time period. Now I'm getting more interested in language over time, over longer time periods, so multiple years. And also there are a lot of methodological challenges like biases in the data. A lot of research also has focused on one particular data source like Twitter. I think it's important to take more data sources into account and look at differences between different social media sources. And also a lot of ethical concerns that are getting increasingly important. So that's it. So thanks for your attention. Oh, yeah, if you have any questions.